Good morning. We are now live streaming. Welcome to Helsinki and StanCon. I want to thank all our sponsors. So we were able to give some student scholarships, free registration, and some students got also some travel funding. Also help all with the keeping the costs low and having still the video streaming and so on. This was easier than I thought to organize this, and thanks for the previous StanCon organizers, Daniel Lee, Breck Baldwin, Mike Betancourt, Jonah Gabri did great job with the submissions, Lauren Kennedy with the finalizing the program, helping here all the time. All my postdoc and students have made great job helping here and feeling good with the how this is going. There's a few things I had to remember to mention here. So Bob Carpenter and Jonah Gabri, they are giving these roadmap talks, and often people have questions, but if the speaker in the end of the presentation asks questions, it's quite often that people need a few minutes to think. Now you have several hours, and for Jonah talk, more than one day to think about the questions. If you want to know where Stan, where Jonah is talking about interfaces, where they are going. Today, at the end of the day, we have Birds of Feather program, Breck. Yeah? This one.
Hello. All right. So this is called Birds of a Feather, and it's short for Birds of a Feather Flock Together. It's if you have something that you're interested in talking about with some person other than you, as many people are as interested, you can have a little organization. So, for example, if I wanted to do one, I might do one on clustering. You'll hand me before 5:17:10 today the title of your talk. You don't have to do it in this form, and then one sentence describing it. I'm going to stand up here at 5:15 and read them all off. You're going to come down. I'll hand you a sheet of paper with the name of your Birds of a Feather group. All right, and you'll come up front here and you'll collect your people. All right, all you need is one other person in order to have a successful Birds of a Feather session. So these are little subtopics about things that you care about. So let's revisit this. I'm Breck. You're going to find me up until 5:10 during the day and hand me your Birds of a Feather description. There's no peer review on this, just whatever you want to do. You're going to tell me what the title is, you're going to write it down, you give me a one-sentence description, and again, Breck, me, find me. If you can't find me and you're confused and whatever, find Aki. Thank you.
Thank you. And, so this was used in Asilomar, and it was great. People were really happy to find other people interested in same topics, and it was also great for Stan developers, because now people were first discussing in a small group what they want to know, and then they came to ask together. So needed to answer only once. Good, very good questions. Posters, so their poster wall company is just installing the poster walls. So during the next break, go hang up your poster. There should be pins. And if someone hasn't got the certificate for the yesterday tutorials, Lauren is over there currently, and she has more after I've signed them. Okay, and then we have two sponsors who are also saying a few words, and let's start with Elisa. Missä?
Good morning, everyone. I'm Nidhi Singh. I'm the Director of Research at ELISA, and today I'll talk very briefly about what we do at ELISA.
Can you speak a little bit closer to
the mic? Okay. I'll talk a little bit about what we do at ELISA, and specifically ELISA research, why we are interested in doing probabilistic programming at ELISA, and what kind of research collaborations we are open for at this point in time. So for those of you who do not know what ELISA is, so ELISA is a telecom company in Finland and Estonia. It was founded way back in 1882, so it's pretty old. And it operates mostly in telecom sector and ICT and online services in general. It has a lot of online services like ELISA Entertainment, ELISA Curia, and so on. Revenue-wise, we're pretty strong. It has 1.8 billion euros in revenue for every year. And it has around 4,700 employees, and we operate mostly in Finland and Estonia. With respect to research that we do, so we mostly do our research in machine learning, and that's why we're interested in doing probabilistic programming that as applied to machine learning. All right, so I cannot talk about all the research problems that we have right now, but I can list out a few domains that we have in our research area. So one of them is smart factory management. There, what we try to do is we try to optimize certain processes using machine learning. And the expected outcome typically is a set of actions that a human operator can take. All right? That's a very generic description of smart factory management, but there's a lot going on, but I cannot go in details. Another application area for machine learning that we have is cybersecurity. It's a big area for us because we receive a lot of threats of different kinds every day. And one simple example is, let's say we want to identify bullying activities in chat rooms. So we have millions of chats, millions of text messages that we have every day, and we want to identify if there's any bullying going on in these chats. Another domain that we have is generic, let's say, network management system, where if we can build a machine learning model that can identify which part of network may go down in the near future, that can enable us to do very comprehensive preventive maintenance. But it's given our data sets and given the generic nature of the problem, it's not an easy problem to solve, so it's a work in progress. Another problem domain that I have is around customer interaction. Now, customer interaction, it may sound very general again, but think of it as developing voice recognition models or NLP models that we have. We can reduce those models in different ways to reduce the workload on our customer care. So customer care in any company is very expensive. So if we can use machine learning models to reduce the load on that customer care department, that's going to have a huge impact on the business. There are many more problem domains I can talk about, but I don't have really the time, but these are the main ones. And the way we do research in ELISA is some things are done in-house, but many of them require some collaborations. So currently, we are collaborating with 1,000 researchers across the globe. We also collaborate with more than 80 startups at this point in time. So with startups, what we do is we discuss some things with them, and if we find that the solutions they're developing is interesting for us, then we can either give them the technical guidance or we can be the early customers for them. And there can be different ways in which we can support them, and we do. Last thing I would like to mention here is we are very actively involved in Finnish Center of AI. I think many of you might know that. We have many projects ongoing with the Aalto University with different research groups. In case you have some questions or you want to contact or you want to discuss some ideas about some potential collaborations, feel free to reach me. I'm here all day. And if you want to discuss it later on, you can also reach me at my email address. Thank you.
Presentation is by Bayer.
Hi everyone, so thank you for giving us the chance to actually present why we sponsored and who we are. I think quite some people know us. We are from Bayer, so I'm Aaron, I'm a senior data scientist at Bayer. I'm here with two other colleagues, Jacob and André. Could you just say hello? Yeah. Just to tell you briefly what Bayer is, maybe we are a life science collaboration, a life science company. So that means on the one hand we work on pharmaceuticals, and we have our goal is really to achieve science for a better life, and we do that with two main motivations. The first motivation is that we try to find cures and drugs for future diseases for our problems, and to actually improve people's quality of life. And on the other hand, we also work on kind of finding new materials, raw materials, and use our expertise in biomedical processes to actually tackle challenges of the future, which we will encounter due to increasing populations and diseases. And so it's a life science company. We have pharmaceuticals, where we actually work on probabilistic programming. So that is prescription drugs, but also on the other hand, we have over-the-counter consumer health, products like aspirin, for instance, you might know, but also crop science, which is where we work on crop detection and seeds, and where also our animal health division belongs to. And Bayer is quite central in Bayer in our work. Here I just briefly put together like one thing which is very important for us, and why we also wanted to support the STAN community is the community aspect, which makes it really special for us. So we have internal communities, like we have a base community. We also support the recently founded STAN user group in Berlin, which is actually honored to host Bob and Mitzi, I think, next week Monday. So if you're in Berlin and you want to see them, just join us. You find us on Meetup. And we have also a journal club where we look into recent activities and papers and kind of exchange and thrive and foster exchange and collaboration. Some of the tools we work currently and we would like to work in the future are like survival models, and I'm thinking we should have one of the birds of like the sessions of discussion about survival models, joint longitudinal time to event, Bayesian neural networks, which we would like to go more deeper in the future, and latent directly allocation. And we are currently looking for data scientists, so if you're keen to work for a life science company, chat with us. I mean, the three of us are here. We are really happy to discuss and tell you a bit about what we do. You see some of the areas where we're looking for recruits. And again, so if you want to chat via email, you can also reach out to me or our head of data science, David Wow. Thank you.
Okay, and it seems that even if we started delayed, did great job with the hurrying up. So we are on time for our first invited speaker, Maggie Lieu, who is from European Space Agency. And overall, also, so in January, Asilomar was my first StanCon. I was really impressed on the variety of applications people are using STAN, how challenging applications. And here also, during these 2 days, we are so varying topics, and this is also the kind of really big because of estimating the mass of galaxy clusters. So you can't get bigger data than that. But please, Maggie.
Thanks, Maggie. Okay, sorry for taking so long to sort that out. Before I start, I want to thank all the organizers for giving me the opportunity to speak here today. I'm going to be talking about hierarchical modeling of galaxy clusters for cosmology. So what I mean by cosmology is trying to understand like how the universe works, and there are a set number of parameters that describe like how the universe was in the past and how it will evolve in the future. Some of the work I'm going to be showing here is work in collaboration with these people here. Right. Okay. So for those of you who are not physicists or astronomers or whatever, the universe started off very hot and very dense. And you can think of it as a photon-baryon plasma. So the light, the photons, were coupled together with the baryons, which is like the matter. And then there were these quantum fluctuations, density fluctuations. And because the universe was so hot and so dense, it began to expand over time. And in these images here, you can see at different time steps the evolution of the universe. So there was expansion, there was gravity, and dense regions became more dense, and less dense regions became less dense. And so the initial fluctuations in the early universe, they grew into this structure that we see today. This is what we call the large-scale structure, or also the cosmic web. And it's kind of like this spongy texture where in the most dense regions, the densest areas, live galaxy clusters. And galaxy clusters are the main interest of my scientific research. They are the largest gravitationally bound objects in our universe, and they're comprised of tens, if not thousands, of galaxies all orbiting around each other. And they're interesting for me because they're rich in dark matter, X-ray emitting gas, and stars and galaxies. So they're ideal laboratories to study astrophysics. From simulations, we know that the universe looks very different depending on the cosmology that defines it. So here you have two different simulations with two different cosmological inputs, and you see that structure clusters very differently depending on this cosmology. This means that galaxy clusters are a very sensitive probe to do cosmology. And one tool that we can use to do cosmology with galaxy clusters is the halo mass function. So this is basically the number of galaxy clusters on the y-axis as a function of mass within a volume and distance, or redshift that we call it. For various input cosmologies, here I'm only looking at the amount of mass matter there is in our universe, and SA or sigma 8 is the size of the fluctuations in our early universe. Depending on these parameters, the halo mass function looks very different. So it seems very simple to do cosmology with galaxy clusters. All you have to do is measure the masses of loads of galaxy clusters, bin them up, and figure out how many galaxy clusters of each mass bin you have. And then you've done cosmology. But it turns out it's not that easy, because mass is not a direct observable. We can't see it directly. But one way that we can infer it is through an effect called gravitational lensing. So this is one of Einstein's theories. And the idea is that if you've got a very far away galaxy and it emits some light, as that light travels towards Earth, it becomes perturbed by any intervening gravitational field. In this case, you've got this massive galaxy cluster in the center, and the light is practically bent by it as it travels to the Earth. So if you imagine, for example, this laser, the light would travel in a straight line. But if gravity of Earth is so strong, it would be able to bend this light, and the light would actually fall to the ground. What this means, in weak gravitational lensing, which is what I use, is that if you've got a load of far, far away galaxies, and they're perfectly circular on the sky, and you were to put a massive galaxy cluster right in the center of it, you'll see that the galaxies, their shapes, are distorted towards the galaxy cluster. And the more mass a galaxy cluster has, the more distortion you'll see on these faraway galaxies behind the galaxy cluster. And this is an effect that we call gravitational shear. And in an ideal world, it would be very easy to measure, because you would just measure the shapes of the galaxies on the sky, and you could just figure out how much mass there is in this galaxy cluster, which is mostly dark matter, which we can't see. But in the real world, things aren't that easy because galaxies are not perfectly circular. They have all shapes and all sizes, and they're orientated very randomly on the sky. So what we have to do is we can break down the ellipticity into two components, a tangential component and a cross component. And these are just determined by the semi-major and minor axes of a galaxy and its position with respect to the galaxy cluster center. And if you average over many, many galaxy ellipticities, you will see that the average tangential ellipticity is equal to the average gravitational shear. If there's no gravitational lensing occurring, then you would expect this signal to be zero on average. And the cross shear is always zero unless you've got something wrong, so it's a systematic check. But galaxy clusters are not solid bodies of mass. They have a density distribution. And so their density falls off as radius to the minus one at close to the cluster center, and radius to the minus two on the outskirts. And so from simulations, we've developed some density profile that quite describes very well galaxy cluster masses. And if you integrate this along the line of sight, because we don't see the 3D structure of galaxy cluster, what we see is a projected image, you can determine its shear. And the shear of galaxy cluster, you can convey this as a shear profile as a function of radius. So this is tangential shear as a function of radius. And it's sensitive mostly to mass. So the mass determines its normalization, and its concentration, how concentrated its mass is sensitive to the slope of this shear profile. So now we know the data, we've got some ellipticities, and we know our model, which is an NFW profile, to give us mass and concentrations. How can we measure a mass and a concentration of a galaxy cluster using Bayesian statistics? Well, we can start off with Bayes' theorem. It's very simple. Posterior probability of A given B equals probability of B given A, which is your likelihood, times a prior probability of A over probability of B, which is the marginal likelihood, or your evidence, which is just pretty much a normalizing factor we don't need to worry very much about. But with this equation, we can write pretty much every model that we need to write. So to fit the mass and concentration of a galaxy cluster, the model that we are fitting, what we're interested in is the probability of a mass and concentration of a galaxy cluster given its shear profile. And using Bayes' theorem, you can write it in this way, where you have a prior on your mass and a prior on your concentration. So the problem is, how do we choose the prior on the masses and concentrations? And a very principled approach is to say that we don't see any galaxy clusters larger than 10 to the 16 solar masses. And anything under 10 to the 13 solar masses is more of a galaxy rather than a galaxy cluster. So you can take like a log uniform prior on mass. And concentration, you can use a uniform between 1 and 10, which is typically used. Or actually, concentration is actually quite difficult to constrain because it's only really constrained by the inner regions of the galaxy cluster, where we usually don't have many background galaxies to calculate the shear. So people often fix it to an external scaling relation between concentration and mass, and this is typically taken from simulations. In STAN, this is really easy to write. And for many years, I wrote like a Metropolis Hastings and ran it on that, and it was just slow as hell. But with STAN, it's really quick. We have a function that describes the NFW profile, and it basically takes in a mass and a concentration and spits out a shear. For the data, we've got the number of data points, your radii, the shear, and the uncertainties on the shear that we observe. And for parameters, I use log mass and concentration. In the model, what I have is we calculate the true shear from the NFW function, given a mass, concentration, and radius. We set the priors down here, and we basically draw the observed shears from the true shears given by the NFW profile at that mass and concentration. But it's not ideal, because galaxies in real life are elliptical, like I said. The shear that it experiences from gravitational lensing changes its shape of the order 1%. And then if we're observing it from Earth, which is typically the case, our galaxies are blurred by the atmosphere and the telescope. We also get pixelization from the detectors, and there's also noise. So measuring a 1% signal on all of this is actually quite hard. And so if you're fitting individual galaxy cluster masses that have a high signal-to-noise ratio, so very massive galaxy clusters, fitting them individually is not that difficult, sure. But most of our galaxy clusters, if you remember the halo mass function, they mostly lie in the low mass range, so they're mostly low signal-to-noise objects. And so in this case, you're pretty much dominated by the prior if you're fitting on an individual basis. Another option you could use is to stack the signals of many galaxy clusters together. And this is what people do typically in my field. But then the problem is, how do you know what galaxy clusters to stack together? Because you don't know their true mass a priori. And you have to assume that all galaxy clusters have the same mass that you're stacking together, which is not the case. And this might misrepresent some outliers. So to summarize what people typically do in my field is that they measure the shapes of galaxies. This might have some calibration and some other errors in. They typically assume Gaussian errors at each stage, and they propagate them through. We fit shear profiles to that, typically using binning, some inappropriate priors, stacking, and then we figure out that actually masses are quite expensive to measure because we need very long observation times. And so we often don't have enough galaxy cluster masses to do cosmology. So what we do is we use scaling relations with other observables that are quite cheap to measure, such as luminosities and temperatures, for example. And we fit a scaling relation to this so that we can generate lots of masses. We bring this up and then fit a halo mass function to get the cosmology. So each of these steps, you're pretty much propagating error after error to get to your cosmology. And this is not good. Masses are very difficult to measure precisely and accurately, especially with weak lensing. And so these errors are propagated through. And if you and they suffer a lot of selection effects and biases, and this one in particular, the Eddington bias, which means the shape of the halo mass function is really steep. So if you're using binning, then a lot of your objects are in low mass bins, and they're more likely to scatter to a high mass bin than high mass objects are to scatter down to a low mass bin. So overall, your shape of your halo mass function that you get this way is going to be biased as well. Oh, that's not meant to be like that. That was meant to say Gaussian. But so ideally, we know that all galaxy clusters, they come from the halo mass function convolved with the selection function. So we don't observe all galaxy clusters from the halo mass function. The low mass objects we're likely to miss because of our constraints from observations. And so one way to get around this is to approximate the halo mass function and selection function as a Gaussian. And all your galaxy cluster masses and concentrations should come from this population distribution. But this distribution is sensitive to your cosmology and the selection functions. So we want to let this be free parameters in our model, and we can fit it with all of our data. And this is basically what hierarchical modeling is. So for a simple hierarchical approach, our priors on mass and concentration, now we simultaneously get all of these from a multivariate Gaussian distribution with some mean and some covariance matrix. And these are parameters that we fit for in our model. And now we're fitting the joint probability of all the galaxy clusters at the same time. So we fit for the population mean of the galaxy clusters, masses and concentrations, and their covariance matrix, all the masses and all the concentrations of all the galaxy clusters at the same time, given all of the shear profiles and their uncertainties. The reason why people haven't been doing this before in my field is just because there's so many parameters to fit for at the same time, and so with something like STAN, we can deal with this. And before, with other samplers, it was very difficult. So you can rewrite that equation in the following form. So now, instead of a prior on mass and concentration, we have this extra likelihood that the masses and concentrations are drawn from the population parameters. And we have some extra priors, though, on the population means and covariances that we have to set. These are called the hyperpriors, and the ones that I use are for the log mass, 32 mean and standard deviation of 1, and 1.5 for the log concentrations, and a width of 0.5. Like Ben said in his talk, we don't need conjugate priors to sample for the covariance matrix, but we can optimize using Chersky factorization. So we decompose the covariance matrix into a correlation matrix and a kind of scale vector, which is basically like a vector of the standard deviations, you can think of it as. And the priors on that, we use a normal on the scale between 0 and 2, and then a LKJ prior on the Chersky factor. That STAN code for that looks like this. So we have all of the galaxy, we have the number of galaxy clusters, we have the number of data points, the radii, the shears observed, the uncertainties on the shears, and then the hyperprior parameters. The parameters that we're fitting are the population means and the covariance parameters and the log log masses and concentrations, basically. And basically, you just, instead of drawing a prior for the masses and concentrations individually, they all come from this mu. And, well, we use a multi-normal Chersky to draw. So instead of sigma, we have the Chersky factor L. We tested this on toy simulations. So here are 38 galaxy clusters. The red is the truth. And the black are like the posterior draws. On average, we recover the shear to within 10% uncertainties, and most of the parameters within 2% uncertainty, which is quite good. In hierarchical modeling, the more data that you have, the better constraints you get on the population. So when we increased this to 200 galaxy clusters, everything improved in terms of the parameters. when you look at going back to how people did it originally, from those simulations, you can see these are binned individual masses, the true masses binned individually, right? And the red are the binned masses that we fit using our hierarchical model. And you can see that the fitted masses are overestimated in the center and kind of underestimated in the tails. And this is simply because using point estimates is never a good idea, because it just doesn't take into account the uncertainties on the individual masses. And so if we do it as a population and take the population mean, we get this distribution, which better estimates the true population overall, rather than taking the individual mass measurements, because it takes into account the uncertainties on all of the mass estimates. To be more realistic, we tested these on hydrodynamical simulations. So these are dark matter simulations. We generate shear from them by doing ray tracing of the light. We get shear catalogs and we fit the shears, etc. 632 galaxy clusters with realistic noise and observations that we see. So here we use 5 galaxies per arc minute squared, which is typically what we observe. If we had better telescopes and longer observation times, this would improve, and it would improve the uncertainties on our data, sure. But this is typically what we're working with, and a realistic shape noise. Again, the red is the truth, and the black are the fitted. Log mass, log concentration. On mass, we recover them really well. So this is the truth on the bottom, and this is the fit, and the equality line is across there. So the masses, we fit quite well. And bear in mind that with simulations, we know the true 3D mass of a galaxy cluster, whereas when we observe, we only see a 2D projection of that. So there is scatter. Concentration is a bit more difficult to constrain, but it's still quite reasonable. You might be thinking that we're mostly dominated by the high signal-to-noise objects, so the most high-mass objects. And here I show that it isn't true. The black dots show you the hierarchical fit, binned up, for all of these little points, and the gray show the non-hierarchical fit. And the point is that because of the halo mass function, we have a lot more low mass systems than we have high mass systems. So these are going to weight more on your population parameters than your high mass systems, even though they have lower uncertainties. Next, applying this to real data, we take the XXL survey, which is 225 square degree patches on the sky using XMM Newton telescope. So these are X-ray detected galaxy clusters, and it's a serendipitous survey, so it's not pointed at each galaxy cluster specifically, we just detect them. We take the brightest 100 galaxy clusters, and we see what weak lensing data that we have from the CFHT lens weak lensing survey. And of these galaxy clusters, 38 of them have low redshifts and temperature measurements. And these are important because higher than a redshift of 0.6, so very far away galaxy clusters, we don't have many background galaxies, because typically, like in lensing, you want background galaxies to be twice as far away as the galaxy cluster to get a good signal. And these are the posteriors that we get on the population. So generally, quite well constrained. So one natural thing that comes out of hierarchical modeling is a thing called shrinkage. Basically, the galaxy cluster masses that we are measuring can be seen as like a quasi-stacking approach because they move towards the population mean. And so on this plot, what I show you is the variance in the population mean mass on the x-axis and the mass value on the y-axis. And these individual points are the 38 galaxy clusters that we measured at their mass value and the population population variance on the log mass that we fit. When we fit non-hierarchically, like treating each of the galaxy clusters independently, we're basically assuming that there's no population, the population variance is infinite because they're all independent of each other and they don't come from an underlying population, right? And these are the values that we got. And we can also fix the population variance value at different values. If we fix it to zero, it would be the same as saying all galaxy cluster masses come from one single value, and you're drawing from that, and it's the same as stacking all the galaxy clusters together. And you can see that basically we're halfway in between like infinity and zero. So this is kind of like stacking that is determined completely by the data alone. You might be thinking that the hyperpriors are really strong, but they really are not. We can calculate this shrinkage parameter, which is like the 1 minus the variance on the posterior divided by the variance on the prior. And from this plot, you see the population mean on mass. That's our posterior. That was the prior. So we're not dominated by the prior at all on our from our hyperpriors. And the same for the scale. Now, comparing non-hierarchical to hierarchical mass measurements, here I'm showing the marginal posteriors on the masses of each of the galaxy clusters. In gray shaded is the posteriors we get when we fit non-hierarchically. And what you see in some of these posteriors is that a lot of them are truncated. And that was simply because we were using harsh prior boundaries. Remember, we were using 10 to the 13 to 10 to the 16. So these posteriors are truncated by that prior. And so if you were to take a mass measurement from that, you would be biasing your results. The black lines show the hierarchical approach. And these are all like pulled towards the posterior mean. And so all the posteriors, even though the prior was quite wide, they don't have this truncation at all. So you don't get upper limit mass measurements. So that's really nice. But ultimately, even though we can now get quite good mass estimates on galaxy clusters, even with very noisy data, ultimately what we want is cosmology. And these masses are going to feed into the cosmology. So why not sample directly from the true halo mass function and not use this Gaussian approximation? So this is where I encountered a problem, because the halo mass function is actually really, really nasty. And I've been having problems like coding this up in Stan, mostly because there are a lot of integrals. A lot of them are improper, so the limits are minus infinity to infinity. And they're multidimensional, so it's integral within integral within integral. And you might be able to do this with an ODE solver, but it's ODE embedded within ODE within ODE ODE. And this is very unstable and very slow to run. So one of the ways I managed to get around this, some of you pure statisticians in the room might not appreciate this, but I developed a PDF estimator, emulator, with a mixture density network. So for those of you who are not familiar with neural networks, basically you take an input, it goes into a neuron, basically, which multiplies it by some weights, adds some bias, and then you have an activation function to determine whether or not that neuron fires, and then it spits out an output. And you compare this to the true value that you expect, and you play around with the weights and biases until you get your truth. And that's basically your neural network trained. In my case, the input for me is the cosmological parameters, the selection function. These go into the neural network and hits a load of neurons with weights and biases and activations that you have to fit for. And then it outputs a number of Gaussian mixtures. So the components, they have weights to make sure that everything sums to one. It has means and variances. And you're going to compare this to the true halar mass function convolved with the selection function with some sort of loss function until the weights and biases turn out good. So step by step of how we develop this is that we sample some cosmological parameters and cluster redshift and selection function parameters. We generate the simulations of the halar mass function convolved with the selection function. This is then input into TensorFlow, which we use to train the weights and biases, and spits out some Gaussian, sensible Gaussian mixtures, and then we save those weights to use in STAN, because then it's very simple, because it's just matrix multiplication and addition, and that's very easy for STAN to differentiate. So I use 20,000 simulations of five parameters. We focus on omega matter, which is like how much matter there is in the universe, sigma 8, which is like the size of the initial fluctuations in the universe. You've got parameters for the selection function and the cluster redshift, or its distance. We use 8 Gaussians in our mixture model, 2 hidden layers, each with 30 nodes. And you can see on this plot that it works really, really well. So the dotted red lines are the fit, and the blue is the true. So the fit is the sum of the Gaussian mixtures, and the true is your true halar mass function with the selection function. And so to estimate the probability of a given mass, then it's just the sum over the weights times the Gaussian components. So it's very simple. In STAN, it looks like this. We've still got the shear profiles of all the galaxy clusters, etc. But now we have data which are the neural network weights that we trained with TensorFlow. And these are just like matrices and vectors, etc. For the parameters, I also add a concentration and mass relation I fit for, as well as the cosmology, the selection function parameters, etc. And this is pretty similar to the other hierarchical model. The new part then is in the model itself. So we have priors on the cosmology and the concentration mass relation. And now, instead of drawing the parameters of the Gaussian that we were doing, we have to draw from this new function, this Gaussian mixture function, we just do target plus and the log sum of the components of the Gaussian mixture. So it's as simple as that. It works very, very well. We tested this on some toy simulations, 557 galaxy clusters. These were the input cosmology and selection, and these were the output. So this is still quite preliminary work. I just finished this up like a week or two ago. So it works quite well. These were the fitted values from STAN. The posteriors look very, very nice. And then I checked with the shrinkage as well to check that I'm not dominated by the priors. So we've got sigma 8, omega matter, and the selection parameters. And in general, it looks good for now. So I'm pretty excited about this. So the next steps of this, of course, is to expand to more cosmological parameters. So there's about 10 cosmological parameters in total. Usually people play around with like 4 or 5, but I'm excited to extend this further. Also, this uses quite small uncertainties on the shear profiles that I generated in the toy model. So I want to test what are the limitations based on the uncertainties on the shears, and how many galaxy clusters we need to constrain the cosmological parameters this way. But this isn't a worry for me, because in the future, what we've got coming up is a lot of weak lensing data. So these are all like the observations, future, ongoing, and completed of weak lensing surveys as a function of area and kind of depth, right? And the ones I'm most excited about are hyperzoom Supreme Cam. You've got deep, ultra-deep, and wide fields. LSST in the US, and Euclid, which is a space-based telescope, which is going to remove all those atmospherical blurs and other things. So we're going to get really accurate weak lensing measurements to come. We're going to get a lot of data. Euclid is going to measure 2 × 10^5 galaxy clusters. So that's going to be more than enough to constrain our cosmology, I think. Yeah, so to wrap that up, cosmology with galaxy clusters tends to be quite difficult because the data is so, so noisy. But we can use hierarchical inference to correctly propagate the errors through, to get better constraints by using lots and lots of data to constrain the noisy data, and to consistently determine how much that we stack, which is much better than what people in my field have been doing so far. So I'll leave it there. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Maggie, for a very interesting talk. Questions? So I'd like to know. Oh, over there. So please draw it further.
Does this work? Okay.
So
I'm not sure if I was able to follow everything, but if I understood correctly, the radial mass profile for the galaxies, that was about the galaxies that were in the background, right?
Yeah.
So those would be of very different vintage.
Sorry?
So those can be at very different distances, so
yeah.
They would be of very different vintage. At some point in the early universe, there were no galaxies. So how can you be sure that galaxies of very different vintage would follow the same radial mass profile function?
Sorry, I answered the first part wrong. So the radial mass profile is of the foreground galaxy cluster, right? And we're just using the background galaxies, their shapes, to infer how much mass is in this galaxy cluster.
So the radial distribution of mass is not important for the background ones?
Well, we use the shapes of the background galaxies to infer the radial profile of the mass. And the more galaxies that we get, the better constraints that we can get on this radial profile, because, like I said, the shapes of the galaxies change of order 1%. They're already intrinsically elliptical, and this change in shear is of 1%. So if we have many, many, many galaxies, then we can get a better signal.
All right, thank you.
Well, so when you fit the hierarchical model to the simulated data, and you showed that sort of fit line of the sort of the clustered versus the hierarchical model, the smaller galaxies were consistently overestimated.
Yeah.
And you could sort of also see that in your shrinkage plot, where the top ones were being pulled down much less than the bottom ones were.
Yeah.
Are you worried? So two questions. Are you worried about that? And have you considered using some sort of asymmetric random effects distribution to sort of control for, allow for different amounts of shrinkage on each side?
I haven't for the latter. I'm not too worried about that because this is pretty much better than what other people have been doing. but it's something that we know about. We tend to have bias estimates on the low mass end because their signal to noise is so low, and so it's more difficult to constrain their masses well. Yeah.
Test. Oh, this is wonderful. Could you go back to the neural network thing real quick? I wanted the little surrogate model thing. Curious about this. I know other people probably are as well. Okay, yeah. The forward. This guy. Okay. So what's happening here is you've got this complicated function. You've got a PDF on this normalized mass thing, and like. It's a function of these four parameters up here.
Yeah.
So what's happening, just to clarify here, is you've got these four parameters that you're going to try to estimate in your model. You're going to use this sort of surrogate density thing to go about doing that. Is that what's happening?
Yeah. So these five parameters, you can use theory to give this blue function.
Okay.
The truth, that's what it looks like. And it's just like integrals over redshifts and masses and all sorts of things. And it's about like 20 pages of theory. So it's really annoying. So we can do this quite easy with numerical integration, and it's quite quick. I'm not sure how accurate it is, but it works. Stan has troubles with that because it's a lot of integrals embedded within each other. That's so instead, if you use a mixture of Gaussians, so like, I don't know where the Gaussians live, but you can imagine eight Gaussians together form the red dotted line when summed together.
That's cool. And did you have any problems did you have any problems with doing like the surrogate modeling stuff with like, and it, you want to build the surrogate model so you're always like interpolating, right?
Yeah.
Did you ever have any problems with like where like the sampler was trying to go outside, or did you just, like how did you handle that situation? You just run more simulations on your surrogate model, like?
So I've got quite tight priors on the cosmology.
Yeah.
And that quite helped, I think.
Cool.
But they.
Okay, very cool. Like, it's neat to see stuff like that work.
Thank you.
Anybody else? I want to throw this. Oh, I see. Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Aim for the middle row here. Guy in the blue. Okay.
Okay. You had the picture with the bins, and you said that they're overemphasized in the center, and then you had to smooth them on the sideways. There is multiple ways of doing that. So what kind of methods you did to get the end result?
The what, sorry?
You had the picture where you had the pinning picture, where you formed the bins.
The pinning picture?
Yeah.
Like... For the shrinkage, or?
No, it was very early.
Early?
Yeah, earlier. This one.
This one?
Yes.
Yeah.
So when you form the bins, and you said that it's overemphasized in the middle.
Yeah.
And underemphasized on the sideways.
Yeah.
What kind of methods you try to get the end result, and what impact it had?
To get the what? Sorry, I'm.
So, how did you? What kind of methods you used?
This is just a histogram of the individual masses. So, if you remember, this is from toy simulations, and so we know the input true masses, and we fit them hierarchically. And if you just take the point estimates and take a histogram of them, you get this, which is pretty much what people do to fit the halo mass function for cosmology, is that they just bin point estimates of objects, and they don't take into account the full posterior of the mass estimates.
Did you try to fix the, well, it looks here very smooth, but if you get this kind of result where you have like bins, you may have like they are not connected in
yeah.
one bin. So how did you make sure that they are like look realistic?
I don't know.
Okay, we need to go for a coffee break so you can continue there.
Sorry.
So thank you.
Thank
again,
you.
Maggie. Hello. Just in case, if you have noticed, there's the electricity available around the room, the black cords and sockets between the benches. So check nearby if you need to charge your laptop.
Great. Here's our speaker. All right, welcome back from the coffee break, everybody. We're going to have our first set of talks, and our first one is from Arya Pourzanjani. Pourzanjani, sorry, I've been in Germany too long. anyway, everybody, please give him a round of applause and welcome him to the stage.
Thank you. All right. I'm Arya. I'm a fifth-year PhD student at UC Santa Barbara, and I'm going to be talking about modeling blood with ODEs and fitting those ODEs when you have not-so-conventional data. But before I do that, I want to motivate why we're studying blood. So to do that, I'm going to ask a question. How many people here are under the age of 45? Okay, so quite a few people, mostly almost everyone, it seemed like. So for people under the age of 45, trauma is the leading cause of mortality. So that's injuries, mostly from car crashes, or getting run over, or shot, something like that. And for people over the age of 45, it's actually the third biggest killer after heart disease and cancer. So why is this relevant to blood? Because if you talk to trauma doctors, a lot of them say that a lot of these patients are dying because they can't stop bleeding and they lose too much blood. So what we study is why they can't stop bleeding. So this talk is in two parts. First, it's the modeling part, where I'm going to talk about the system we're using and how we actually get the data and measure this system. And then that's going to lead into fitting the system in Stan and kind of more of the mathy part. All right, so human blood consists of, well, amongst other things, several proteins that are interacting over time to form clots. So one protein activates another, which activates another, which eventually down the line turns one other protein into something that can hold a clot. And then you have other proteins that interact to break down the clot. And all these proteins are blocked by other proteins. So it's this big complicated system that I've sort of whittled down into seven key players here. And all of this can be modeled using a system of ODEs. So something like that, which is what I've been using. And from that, you can simulate these states, and what you get is a profile of all of these proteins over time. So that third one from the bottom that kind of starts at zero and slopes up, that's one of the key proteins that holds together clots. So that's kind of useful to know. And so there's two ways doctors can actually measure the states of this coagulation system. The first is they can take blood samples and directly measure the concentrations of each protein. So that's nice and informative and direct. The problem is that those assays are generally expensive, and they take a while to run, and they're usually only available at like research hospitals. And the slow part is pretty important because in trauma, getting the right care quickly is of the essence. So the other way to measure this system is through a technique called thromboelastography, or TEG for short. And what this is it measures the blood viscosity rather than proteins directly by moving a small probe through a sample of blood as it's clotting. So if you imagine moving your finger through a bowl of honey, it's harder than moving your finger through water. And so same concept here. We can move a probe through blood as it's clotting to measure its how big or clotted it is over time. And so what you get is a time profile kind of like that, where on the x-axis you have time, and kind of on the y-axis you have, well, it's kind of mirrored here so that it kind of resembles an actual clot, but that's basically viscosity over time of the clotting process. So this assay is ubiquitous. I think it's available in most hospitals in the US and Europe. There's something equivalent nowadays. It's fast and cheap, but it's clearly a level of abstraction away from the underlying system of proteins. And the other issue is that the way this data is communicated and stored is not by looking at one of these graphs. It's actually by looking at some of these summary parameters. So for example, MA, the maximum amplitude, is the value of the, well, the biggest the clot ever gets in millimeters. And R there is the time, the first time that the clot gets bigger than a certain value. So you could think of that as how long it takes for the body to start forming a clot. And there's others I'll talk more about in a bit. So what a data set might look like is here's a male patient, age 22, who had a stab wound, and we might have some protein measurements, and then we'll have some TEG measurements, in this case, the R, the K, the MA, and the Li 30, which I'll explain more about in a bit. Okay, so the name of the game here is going to be translating the TEG parameters, which are easy and cheap to get, into this into actual protein values, which are more informative of kind of what's going on under the hood, so to speak. And so why would this be useful? Because it would help in diagnosis and better understanding clotting. For example, if a patient isn't clotting because they're low on a certain protein, then we can replace that protein for them. Or we can take TEG data that's already been recorded and use that to better understand what happens to the clotting system during trauma. Okay, but the question is how? How do you take the weird maximum amplitude and first hitting time data and convert that into proteins? And the answer is by modeling the generative process and fitting it in Stan, just like any other problem. So let me talk about the generative process now. Basically, we start with our protein ODE system, Y prime equals F of Y, and we solve that, and we get those solution curves. So those are representing the proteins over time, and we can call that Y of T. It's just a function of time. And then from that, we have to translate the protein into clot thickness. And so this is one functional way to kind of do that. And so that's a clot thickness curve over time. And so that's typically what you'd get from running a running TEG, except in the data, you'd actually get the summary parameters. So there's one more step. And the way those work is, for example, the R is the first time that the clot viscosity is above 0.02. The K is the first time the clot viscosity is above 20 millimeters. The MA is the maximum amplitude. And the Li 30 is the amplitude of the clot after 30 minutes divided by its max amplitude. So that's the data we actually have, not an actual measurement of a curve, which is more typical when you're fitting ODEs. You have these hitting times instead. So there's one problem with this that you'll notice is that to get these hitting times and the max, you actually need a continuous function, but that's not what we get when we solve an ODE numerically. We actually get the solution at a discrete number of points. So that means we're going to get the clot thickness at a discrete number of points, and so we can't get continuous hitting times and continuous max amplitude from that. So to make a long story short, we're going to have to use some interpolation technique. So I'll go over this part quick since I'm running out of time. but basically the way we ended up doing it here is by taking those points and using cubic splines to interpolate the solution points. And the reason we did that was because we wanted a smooth differentiable function so that we can call things like a Newton solver on it to solve for the roots of the equation, of the derivative, so we could get the hitting times and the maximum and so forth. So we went with cubic splines, which, as a lot of you may know, is just piecewise defined cubic functions. And the way you fit them, you end up having to solve a tridiagonal matrix. So you have to use a special solver for tridiagonal matrices called the Thomas solver, which scales in linear time with the size of the matrix, which is pretty easy to code up in Stan. So once we get that continuous form, then we can start running our root finding algorithms, such as Stan's built-in Newton method, or in our case, we coded up a custom bisection method for finding the roots in C++. I think at the time we were doing this, we couldn't specify initial guesses for the Newton iterations, so that's why we went with that choice. So once we have all of that, then the uncertainty from our data sort of propagates up our generative process, and then we have different possibilities of the clot thickness curve and different possible realizations of the actual protein curves over time, as you'll see there, and eventually a distribution on the possible initial conditions of proteins. And so from that original data, you can see that patient was missing their TPA protein measurement. So that's, I took draws from their prior there up top, which comes from the population distribution. And then at the bottom is their posterior, which then incorporates those four pieces of TEG data. So you can see we're actually getting information from that, which is useful, that we didn't have before. So mission accomplished. Okay, I'd like to thank my colleagues, Ben and Ty and the rest of the Petzold lab at UCSB, and Eric and Daniel Lee of the Generable crew in New York. Thank you.
Great presentation, thank you very much. So some of the sundial solver, which is the solver that's used in Stan,
that's right,
does actually have a root root finding capability, so you don't have to do all that.
Yeah,
I think Stan doesn't expose it, is it perhaps the problem?
Stan does have a root finding solver that uses the Newton's method. And Newton's method, as you may know, is sensitive to the initial guess. So the initial guess of the root you use. And at the time we were working on this, I don't think you could specify that initial guess dynamically in Stan. So we decided to go with our own custom root finding solver that was more or less straightforward to write, but I think that might have changed recently.
Right. Sorry, mm-hmm. Another question, which is that data will be very noisy. I mean, I've worked on hemoglobin measurements, and you can send the same sample to aliquots to two different labs, and you'll get a different reading for exactly the same sample. So, how did you talk about that a bit? How the the data was noisy and?
Yeah, that's kind of an interesting modeling question. And it's hard because for these patients, we didn't have repeat samples of the same measurement. So we're kind of having to estimate the variance of the noise distribution over patients rather than within patients, more or less.
Yeah. Thanks.
All right, so by doing a cubic fitting, basically you introduce some bias for the solution, right? How do you account for that?
Right, so the actual solution of the ODE, the true solution probably isn't a cubic spline, you're right. But we figured that it was close enough that the numerical error introduced there would be small relative to the errors on the things we wanted to estimate. So, yeah, and it seemed to do well in our initial tests. I mean, there you can see an example of it fit to discrete solution points.
Hi, nice talk. I have a question. Some of the concentration plots, they look like they would be non-decreasing. So there could be some, is there any way monotonicity you could exploit for the splines, like ice splines, for instance? Have you tried that, or did that didn't work for you?
So for the clot thickness curves, they're actually not totally monotonic. Mm-hmm. Like this curve, if you look closely, once it hits the peak, it starts to decay a little, and that's representing the clot breaking up. So for here, we just went with regular cubic splines rather than monotonic splines.
All right. Let's give Arya a hand.
I see. Oh, cool. Yeah, that looks better. First, I'd like to thank Ati Honkela and his colleagues, who's somewhere around, because this work was greatly inspired by his paper, which wasn't in Stan, so I moved to Stan and learned a lot along the way. So, the thing we're working with is gene expression, which is the process where you have DNA, and there are some proteins binding to the DNA, and then the genes, some parts of the DNA get copied and they are expressed and they influence the behavior of the cell. We are particularly interested in other molecules, proteins that influence whether a gene is expressed or not, which in the end is the way the DNA program is executed, or to some extent. This is a great simplification. You can measure gene expression. And for example, one of the data sets we work with look like this. So this is from bacteria. You have measurements of gene expression over time. The units here are quite arbitrary. This is microarray data, so the units are not really meaningful. And we see that some of the genes are not expressed almost at all over time. Some raise in expression. There's lots of dynamics going on. this is actually quite a big data set for this kind of problem, because usually you have very few measurements. This one has 14, which is a lot. Sometimes you get 4, sometimes you get 20, but this is relatively big. So that's why Bayesian approach is appealing, because we don't have a lot of measurements. We, on the other hand, we have a lot of genes. So even like simple bacteria have several thousand genes. So like the data are big in this dimension, but we don't have a lot of measurements for the same gene. And our task here is to try to figure out, looking at these time series of expression, try to figure out which interactions between the genes are plausible. So which genes might have influenced the expression of other genes. So that's the question we are trying to answer. So we have some idea of how the influence of the regulator on the target gene might look like. And this, we use this differential equation to describe this. So where XY is one of the possible target genes, so the change of its expression or its mRNA level, so this is just the synonym for expression, over time, is dependent on certain set of regulators, of expression of certain regulators, which are weighted. So we have some regulatory weights, some are more important, some are positive, some are negative. There is just a threshold to have nice linear combination. This is fed through a nonlinear function and multiplied by some like maximum synthesis of the mRNA. So this is the synthesis term. So we know that the regulators influence how much of new mRNA is synthesized, how the expression rises. At the same time, there is degradation, which we assume happens at constant velocity, which is a great simplification, but everything in biology is a simplification if you want to model it. So we just hope this works. So this is our relationship between if we know the regulator, how we expect the target to behave. Also, I'm going to use, from time to time, I'm going to use rho to signify just the linear combination that's fed to the function. And here the function, we use a sigmoid function, because at low concentrations we expect no expression to occur, and at high when the regulator input is very high, we expect that the cell can produce the product only at a certain rate, so there's a maximum rate to be reached, and after that any increase in regulators will have no effect. And we use the standard logistic sigmoid to model this fact. One more thing, because we cannot observe directly the expression is observed noisily. We have to model the unobserved state of the regulators. And I've tried two ways to do this. I've worked with Gaussian processes, and they were a pain. And I'm not really sure I totally understand it, but I couldn't get them to work, although they are very appealing theoretically, and also they are kind of computationally expensive, so you need to decompose the metrics to draw from the normal distributions. And they were problematic also computationally. So I switched to splines, which were way faster because you just multiply a matrix. On the other hand, they are slightly less intuitive in setting priors for, and you have some tunic parameters like the number of knots that are not very straightforward to set. So that's a huge disadvantage, but it makes the model work a bit better in my examples. So, well, that's it. And in a perfect world, you would work with what's something I would call the big model. So you would take all the regulators you expect there to be, because there are some ways biologists know which genes are possible regulators. And you would take all the possible targets, for example, from different experiments you can check like where which genes might be influenced in some way. And you would fit one big model where you would consider all the interactions. And this has several issues. One of them is that this model is big and has lots of parameters, so it's slow. And the bigger problem is that we are not sure which interactions take place. But if we build the big model, it implicitly assumes that, you know, that there is a relationship because we are the model equation. So if the lots of the genes we consider possible targets are actually not influenced by the regulator, when fitting the big model, then the downstream genes will influence the latent state of the regulator. And they may actually shift like the regulator way away from what was measured just because we've included genes that are actually not regulated. And the only thing I know how to resolve that would be to add a discrete latent variable, like is the regulation taking place or not. Then you would have to marginalize over all the possible 2 to the n states, which blows up very quickly. So that's one of the things I'm super happy. If you have some ideas how to solve that, so just please get in touch. I'll be super happy to hear some ideas. But instead, what I do is look at one target at a time, which makes this problem go away. And you know, if the model doesn't fit, I believe that the regulation is not really taking place. And sometimes, because we don't have a lot of data, we usually actually only have one regulator and one target, or up to two regulators. Because when you have two or three regulators, you can already fit almost all the data I have with any combination whatsoever, because it's just so little data. So that's the small model, and I'm gonna work primarily with the small model. And one more thing we need to do is we need to solve the differential equation. This is a reformulation of the equation. This is a reformulation of the equation, and you'll notice that it's linear in X, so in the concentration of the target gene, it's linear. So we don't really have to use some ODE solver, and we can transform that into two parts. Here we have the initial concentration and exponential decay, which is one parameter. And then we have a definite integral that integrates over all these syntheses times the exponential decay. Yeah? So that's the nice part of having constant decay. We can solve the equation and move to a definite integral. And this integral is easy to solve with trapezoid rule, and it's quite easy to implement in STAN in linear time, works wonders. There are some huge issues with the way the model is used by default, because this differential equation is used across a lot of publications already. And one of the problems is that for some data, you cannot really distinguish the sign of the regulation, the sign of the weight, whether the gene activates the target or represses. And here's a simple example. So the red line here is the regulator. The red dots are the measured target concentration with some noise. And you'll notice that we cannot really say whether a green curve or the blue curve is more plausible. But if you look at the parameters right there, we see that green curve has W of 5, while blue curve has W of minus 5, and they differ in lots of other parameters. So this is like a huge issue, huge problem, and the only way I was able to overcome this non-identifiability is to just fix the sign of W. So I put this as data, just assuming that we want to check positive and negative regulations separately. And this is not a big deal because we're working with one target at a time. So if you're interested in both variants, you can easily check both of them. But if we work with the big model, that would be another complication. I hope I have enough time for this. Anyway, there are other non-identifiabilities. For example, if we do a linear transform of W and B in certain situations when the input is at the tail of the sigmoid, you'll notice that although we are changing W and B substantially, the resulting curves are almost identical. These are three curves. If you don't see just three curves, they're almost identical. And this is because at the tail of the sigmoid is approximately linear at the scales we're working at. And so linear transformation of the parameters doesn't really have a huge effect. Uh, Or when we work with the synthesis and degradation parameters, once again, we can change them substantially. Here you see we move from S10 to S180. And if we also increase D, we get very similar curves. And once again, if you assume that the red dots are what was measured, there's not really, we cannot really say like which of these curves is more plausible, but they differ substantially in the parameter values. So which poses all sorts of problems for Stan. But luckily, this is solvable by a reparameterization. Where reminding the model equation and that we use rho I to determine the linear combination, we can, instead of working directly with the parameters, we introduce new parameter to represent the mean value of the regulatory input, and another to represent the standard deviation of the regulatory input. And now we've collapsed all the lots of those W and B combinations together, so if we're in the tail of the sigmoid, we still have I got a bit tangled in it. It's easy to put priors on those, so we can say things like we assume the input to be around zero, around the center of the sigmoid, and we assume that we don't really reach at the very tails of the sigmoid because nothing interesting happens there, and it resolves a lot of things. But we need to know the sign of the regulation. And we also have another parameter, which is derived from S over D, normalized over the some of the expression values we observe, which is nice because this is not related to the data. This is not under units of data. This is dimensionless quantity. I skipped a lot of things. So the model has multiple uses, which you can check out in the use case online. Then I use comparison about against several baseline models to determine if the regulation actually takes place. So if the model with the regulation fits the data better than model where no regulation is assumed, using Lieu or Wyke, which you can find in the case study. It does work okay-ish. For some reasons, it's not that better than using maximum likelihood over the same model with Stan, and I'm still looking into why this is the case, because it should, I mean, Stan is great, it should work better than maximum likelihood, but it doesn't. And I'll be super happy to hear your ideas to prove me wrong and show me that it's possible to fit the big model, or that there's a better way to work with the ODE, or that I should not provide the regulation sign as data and, you know, have some other approach to this problem. So you can check out the source code and everything else online. And I'm wondering, what are your questions?
You have some questions for Mark?
Hi. For the trapezoid rule, how do you use an adaptive step size or width of the trapezoids, or?
Yeah, not really. This is set as data. So you assume, because you know, like the data are measured like every 30 minutes or something. No, this is like 15 minutes, every 15 minutes. So you assume that like every minute, 1 minute time step is okay, and you run with that.
Okay, I think the 1D integrator in Stan is coming out soon, which probably you could get a good speed up from because it's able to probably adapt the step size.
Yeah, well, I'm really looking forward to the 1D integrator, but I'm not sure it's going to help because there's a stupid dependency between time and the latent regulator profiles. And so as far as I understand, the regulator will require me to be able to evaluate the derivative at arbitrary time points, which I probably won't be able to do because I have the spline basis for only for certain points. So it either would be inconvenient with the recompute spline basis for every evaluation needed in the integrator, Or if I would use Gaussian processes, I would probably be completely in trouble, because I would need to, like, I have like an array of parameters and I need to interpolate between them to get the regulator value at arbitrary time points. So I think that's going to be difficult. I'll be happy to be proven wrong, but I think that the integrator might not help.
Thank you. Thanks for the presentation. About the big model, all I was thinking about is that you have those, if you have time series and you want to there in Stan, for instance, in the profit library, if you want to model change points, then you simply use a very sparse prior on each of the individual change point, like, did something change here, yes or no?
Yeah.
And then I thought maybe you might be able to use such a thing rather than zero or one that you said, but just put a very sparse prior on it and everything. But I'm far from an expert, and I'm guessing there is an expert in the room, so.
Yeah, okay, thank you. I'm going to have a look into that. Thank you.
Cool. Contact me afterwards.
Thanks. So I was wondering, since you have all those kinds of non-identifiability issues, is this sort of an appropriate model at all? So do we get something out of, sort of in terms of understanding of what happens, even if we sort of get some result of the ODE, given some constraints?
Yeah, okay, that's a good question. So there are two reasons I use this model. One, because my boss told me to. and two, there are some theoretical reasons that you can derive this as a special case of when you model like actual like binding events on the DNA, then this can be derived as a special case with certain simplifications. So in that, it's appealing also from theoretical perspective, this model. Yeah. So. If that's an answer.
Yeah, thanks.
So I didn't really follow, I mean, where do you get these regulator profiles? Is it just a completely latent variable? Because, I mean, these regulators are proteins that have genes, are being translated from genes that you typically would measure. So are you taking this information into account?
Yeah, thanks. Sorry if that was not clear. So. I generally assume that I have measurements of the regulator. So for the bacterial case, we can actually assume that mostly there are some caveats that you can actually get away with assuming that the protein concentration is proportional to the mRNA concentration, which is not that okay assumption in eukaryotes, as far as I know. But we treat those as measured with some error. So you either can assume that the gene expression is related to the regulatory protein level, or you can introduce one more layer of differential equations where you assume that there is some process that translates from mRNA to the protein that actually regulates the target.
We have one more speaker. Could we get the cube too? Wow. No harm done. All right. I'm sorry. Where's our, oh, that's you. Oh, there you are. Sorry. Come on up. You got your slide down.
Yes. So thank you. This talk was originally supposed to be given by Sebastian Weber, who's working in statistical methodology group at Novartis. And he's also one of the developers of STAN. But unfortunately, with quite short notice, I had to step in here, so bear with me. So I'm going to talk about solving original differential equations in the wild, and how to do scalable pharmacometrics with STAN. So the outline of the talk is first I'm going to motivate you, like what is pharmacometric modeling, and then with one case study for this drug called warfarin, I'm going to show you how we can actually do it, and finally conclude. So first about pharmacometric modeling. So whenever we are doing a drug therapy, we aim to treat some disease. And when we take some drug, it's administered somehow into our body. And we do this for the drug or the active compound of the drug to reach some part of the of our body where it does its trick. And often we take the blood concentration in the body as a surrogate for the like how well the drug works. And usually drug research data, it contains lots of individual patients for which we have measured how much drug we give at given times, and what is the drug concentration on the blood at given times for some period of time for which the drug study lasts. And in pharmacometrics, we aim to model this process. And it's one way to think of it is to divide it to two parts. So first, pharmacometrics, shortened as PEIKI, and it is the relation of drug administration to the concentration of the drug in the blood. And then the second part is pharmacodynamics, which is the relation of the drug concentration to the wanted effect. And to make this easier to think or in your minds, so pharmacokinetics is what the body does to the drug, and pharmacodynamics is what drug does to the body. And these processes are stated as ordinal differential equations, which we have already talked quite a lot today. And because we have two different ordinal differential equations, we need some link process for them. And here is a figure for you to get it again. So we take a drug, then we have the pharmacokinetic model, which outputs a concentration, and then we use that concentration to get a response. Cool. So how we learn pharmacometric models? It would be good if we would be able to, or if we learned both ODEs at once, but unfortunately this is quite time taking. So what we do instead, usually, we solve the first ODE first, then we fix the parameters and use that as a forcing function for the second model. And this is not the ideal solution, but this is faster for the modeler, and actually also the model is faster. And in this work, we concentrate on speeding up the pharmacodynamic models as they give a great example of this forcing functions. And more often, they cannot be solved analytically. And then to get to the case study. And first, I'm going to show you the pharmacometric model of this drug warfarin. So, as you remember, the model consists of two parts, and we can solve the pharmacokinetic model of warfarin analytically. And tada, here is the solution. You don't need to know the details, but we can input the patient details, and we can output the concentration. And this, what you see here, this is the probabilistic output. But we use this as a forcing function, and it is often done, and we fix it to the means. And then to the pharmacodynamic model of warfarin, which is our main concentration, which we concentrate on here. So warfarin is a blood thinner, and quantitative measure of it is change of prothrombin levels in blood. And this is related to the blood thickness in the, or blood thickness, a measure of blood thickness. And as I said, concentration over time, we have solved the ODE and we fix the parameters to mean and use this as a forcing function for the pharmacodynamic model. And the pharmacodynamics is described by this semi-mechanistic process you can see here. And R is the response, Ks are influx and outflux constants, and EC50 is a concentration when we have a 50% response of the maximum. And unfortunately, this turnover model cannot be solved analytically. And now I'm going to tell you how we can speed the STAN model, because it's quite slow if we don't think it well in advance. So if we would model the pharmacodynamic or the turnover function with STAN, the function could look something like this. So we take the input of the we take the data as input, then for conveniency we rename or make the code more readable, then we pass them to the function solving the ODE, and then we do the math for the semi-mechanistic model and return the solution. But for this STAN run for 32 patients with 250 warm-up and sampling, it takes about 15 minutes. And this is bad. And why this is bad is because currently in STAN, when we use variable definitions in functions, they are considered as parameters. And when we have more parameters, the autodiff tree grows a lot. And we want to avoid this because in this case, they are actually not parameters. They are fully dependent on the data. So by thinking wisely, we can define this function in a way where we don't use the variables. We just pass the data straight to the function. And again, STAN run 250 iterations, warm-up and sampling, and for 32 patients, we now use 7 minutes. And this is purely because the autodiff tree isn't that high. And as we have spoken yesterday, for those who were participating in the workshops, in the ODE workshop, usually the problem definition for pharmacometric models, they are hierarchical and they are embarrassingly parallel. This means that for each patient, we can compute the likelihood independent of others, and we can speed things up. And the likelihood of a given patient, so as I said, can be computed in independence to all other patients. And now, unlike 1 year ago, this structure can be taken advantage of in STAN with this new map-rect functionality. And this function applies user-defined function to a set of parameters which are of rectangular shape. And these evaluations can be performed on a cluster using the MPI interface or parallelized on one computer. And when we compare the times, so here on the x-axis we have the cores or amount of computers we are parallelizing the function to, and then on y-axis we have the computation time. So using threading, we get 4.2 time increase using 16 cores, and using the MPI on a cluster, we get 6.6 increase, which is quite impressive, and we couldn't do this 1 year ago. And then finally, to conclude, we can go from 15 minutes to 45 seconds using these two tricks. And nowadays, Stan has all required components to do scalable pharmacodynamic modeling. And in future, it is in the Stan 3 language, we can also define in functions which parameters are defined straight from data and which parameters actually are parameters. And because of this, we can actually make the code more readable in the future while still having the computational performance. And map rect function, which is new in Stan, gives huge performance gains for large problems, as you could see. Thank you. And as a disclaimer, so I didn't do the work, and I'm here just to present for Sebastian, but luckily we have lots of Stan developers, so if you have questions about the details of the map rect or new Stan functionalities, I have lots of sidekicks here.
Okay, well, let's see if we need them. So there's the, in one of your earlier, I think slide 9 was it? There you showed the posterior from the PK model.
Yes.
And I shouldn't. These are quite noisy, actually. Do you think that it's maybe also using hierarchical modeling or some sort of smoothing could make these better?
To be honest, I don't know how to answer that question, but yes, actually it is using hierarchical modeling at the moment, so I don't know why these are so noisy. This is, well, I'm sorry, yeah. I cannot yeah. answer okay. the question.
Yesterday, I think when we were in the ODE tutorial, someone said there was a linear speed up with the number of cores, and looking at your chart, it seemed to have a sort of limit about, well, sort of for MPI about 6 times and for threading about 4 times. Is that just the particular problem, or I mean, I certainly was surprised you got linear.
Well, there are also different parts in the models besides the thing that we parallelize.
Yeah.
So, because if everything was parallelizable, then we could get like linear. But there are parts that we
yeah,
have.
I've never seen that myself. That's all. You know, I've always had a limit.
Sebastian has a lot. Sebastian, the guy whose paper this actually built most of this, and there's a lot of evaluation of things on the Stan website. So Sebastian's run with 10 separate machines with 8 cores each and gotten like a 60 times speed up on these models. So it's not exactly embarrassingly parallelizable, but when you have a likelihood function that's doing a lot of separable work, it's pretty close. And that was using like an InfiniBand backplane. It wasn't even on shared memory machines. So Yeah, so it's this problem is pretty simple because it's we can ship the data off to the particular cores with this MPI thing. So all we ship back and forth is the parameters, and then all the hard ODE solving and thing happens on those cores, and it's a very lightweight communication. But it all has to be integrated back into the auto diff tree, which is a little overhead. So it's not perfectly linear, but for a lot of problems, it's pretty close.
Yeah. Yeah, and to add what Sebastian wants to underline currently, using one computer, like currently the MPI interface, it's faster when we put it on the cluster when comparing the threading. So that's also one thing to keep in mind, and that's apparently related to how things are implemented in STAN. And maybe it's gonna be better in the future for threading.
Okay, I think we need to move on. That was fantastic. Let's thank all of our speakers.
I really want to keep this thing. Maybe next time.
It's on? Okay, cool. So next up we have some poster spotlights. So the idea of this is people presenting posters are going to do really short presentations to sort of highlight the coolest things about their poster, and then you can go and see it afterwards. They'll be by their poster. And the posters are on the third floor, so one floor up. And I think most of them are up now, but if you haven't put yours up and you have a poster, you can pop up and do it in the lunch break. So the people in this session, if you want to come up, I think Ilaria is first. All right, so first up is Ilaria, and she's talking about estimating flood probability bands using flood event data.
Yes, the title in the program is even longer than that. this is because I am starting to understand how Bayesian statistics work, so I need your advice on a bunch of things. So we were asked at a study group type of event how the decision makers could use some very sparse data about flood events to reassess flood risk in specific areas. So the data we have look like something like this. So we have incredibly small data. If you get 20 years of records, you're lucky. You might observe, say, 4 floods in a specific place over 20 years. And we would want to use this data to make an assessment of what is the risk of flooding in a place. So you don't have a lot to work with. But there are, so we use a conjugate prior. We use the simplest possible model. As it happens, I estimate this model in Excel. Because that's what users use. the poster and my questions to you are about how can I choose some sensible priors for this problem. We have some information on what is the official estimated risk at a place, but this comes in an interval, not as a continuous information. So I need to transfer interval information into a beta distribution for my probability of flooding, and that's not incredibly easy. Experts know something about this stuff, but yeah, I don't know how to do the elicitation, so I'll be very happy to have some pointers about that. And then eventually I also need to provide some useful outcomes, which is not a beta distribution, but something about the actual flood probabilities. And because of regulations, these need to be in intervals again. So it's not so straightforward. And I also think this is a pretty good toy example, and if anybody, I'm pretty sure some of you teaches an introduction to Bayesian statistics. This is a pretty good example, I think, to show how it's important to use informative priors, because the standard prior of assuming that no flood and flood is equal across the range is not true, because we normally know that it doesn't flood every year in a place. So this is a pretty good sort of like example for using informative priors. So come and see and talk to me.
Okay. Hi, folks. So today I'd just like to present briefly a little bit of my work developing the CT-SEM package for R, which is basically a front end for Stan to do state-space modeling with the option of turning it into a continuous time state-space model and the option of doing this in a hierarchical formulation. So a general state-space model is characterized by a set of by a set of latent processes, eta. These change according to some deterministic function of the previous states, some deterministic function of known inputs, and there's some uncertainty in our function, which is basically what's distinguishing it from a lot of the ODE stuff we've been seeing, because in this sense we're acknowledging that we really don't know the model particularly well, so we're allowing uncertainty in the state function. Then the states are at various points are measured by some deterministic function, and again plus some uncertainty, but here the uncertainty doesn't feed forward through the system, it's just uncertainty at the measurement level. We can see this here. We see basically we see our estimate for the latent states shown by the thick red line. We see the observations shown by the circles. We have this change from our state here up to here. Then we get more knowledge about the system from an observation here, which then updates the state downwards slightly. And we're wrapping all this in a hierarchical formulation. We have a multivariate normal going on here with any covariates we want, and we have some transformation function to actually set up the matrices we need, whether they're variants or all sorts of structures. So this works by basically you pass in a set of input matrices containing any fixed and free values, set up the priors and individual variation as you like. And then you pass this to a fitting function which sets up a Stan model which incorporates an integration over any possible states at a measurement occasion using either classic or uncentered Kalman filter. It does an integration between across states between states at different times using either an analytic solution or numerical integration. And then we can either sample or integrate over differences between different subjects, and then there's the option of either using the wonderful nuts Hamiltonian sampling, or for cases where we want it to be fast, we can also do an optimization and important sampling loop. This sort of thing could be useful for cases like single subject time series with like a REMA or continuous time versions. Panel data or dynamic systems. Could also think about it for cases where Gaussian process regression is applicable. And great, I'd love to talk to any of you about it. Cheers.
I'm Breck Baldwin. Congratulations, you now have a governing body. I'm going to explain to you briefly what that is. I'm going to have a poster where you can come and talk to me or any governing body member that happens to be there to talk about it. And so basically the idea is that we had an election in the Stan Developers Only group with 32 people, unanimous vote to install this governing body. 20 people voted, nobody said no, and the memberships are there. I'm the executive director, which means that I'm the runaround guy trying to get things done day to day, but I have no actual authority beyond just running around doing things. Andrew Gelman's chairman of the board, and here Jonah's on there on the committee, Sean Taltz, who else is on? Dan Simpson, I think that's it, right? Daniel Lee. All right, so those are people you can talk to that are on the body now. The important bit is, let's just get to the end. Oh, and also Bob is not a part of the Stan governing body by his choice. He's running the technical working group. So that's a different thing that he's running, and you can talk to him about that. We are all things Stan, but I'm not going to worry about that. The important thing is we're provisional. So we need a new governing body in a year. If you're interested in being on it, if you're interested in serving on it now, please come talk to me. And what else? Yeah, so basically, come talk to me if you're interested in anything about fundraising, helping us guide Stan in the future. We don't care about seniority, we care about energy and commitment to Stan. Thank you.
Oh, that's it.
Awesome. So that's it. But we'll continue to have more poster spotlights throughout the conference. So after you get your lunch, you should go upstairs to level 3 and check out all the posters. There's some really good ones. And before you all run off, if you are doing the contributed talks in the next session, can you stay here and just come down to the front so we can make sure everything's working all right? And Aki?
So the lunch is outside on the hallway. Let the poster presenters to get lunch first so that they can get to the posters, and then you get lunch, and then you can take your lunch with you and then go see the posters. And specifically, go see now posters by the spotlight presenters. Thank you.